I'm Mayor Sandra Berry of the Village of Oak Lawn, and I'm here today with our MWRD Commissioner, Mariana Spiropoulos. We're here to talk about issues regarding our water, both with respect to drinking and flooding and stormwater, what residents should know about it, and what we're trying to do to prevent flooding in the future. So welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, Mayor. I appreciate
it. It's very nice. Now, you're a commissioner. How
Correct.
Many commissioners are there?
So we're a countywide agency, and we have 9 commissioners on the board. Every 2 years, 3 of them are elected,
okay.
or 3 of us are elected. I was elected in 2010 for a 6-year term, so I'll be up again in 2016. And it's a nice period of time, so, you know, because it's a very large county, 883 square miles, and it gives you a lot of opportunity to go out to each of the communities and meet a lot of people. So.
Now, what is MWRD?
It's a great question. A lot of people think that we are the drinking water, the agency that mm-hmm. Is in charge of drinking water, but we are on the other end in terms of wastewater. Mm-hmm. We do 2 things. We treat wastewater and we manage stormwater. We treat mm-hmm. the wastewater at 7 filtration plants throughout Cook County, and we manage stormwater through our deep tunnel system as well as our ordinance.
Okay. Now, most residents don't think of what happens to water either when it goes down the drain or down, the storm sewers. Do those 2 systems carry all the water, or are there, is the water going down the drain in your house the same as water going down the storm sewers you see on the street?
So that's a great question. Most of the systems are combined sewer systems, so mm-hmm. they have storm water and wastewater together. And it is connected to everyone's home.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have the local sewer system connected to the home and then connected to interceptors, which is where the Water Reclamation District comes into play.
Okay.
And that carries everything from your dishwasher, your toilet, your sink, your shower, your washing machine, all of that is taken to whichever treatment plant is closest.
So that's like dirty water then?
Correct.
Okay, and then rainwater is kind of clean water, right?
Correct,
okay.
And that's combined. So ideally, when you build your new community somewhere, mm-hmm. You're going to build a separate sewer system so that
okay.
you can use that storm water for irrigation purposes, agricultural purposes, rather than having it go to waste, which is what happens now.
Right. Residents think of flooding as when the riverbanks overflow, and in Oak Lawn, it's really when the storm sewers can't hold all the water. That's what makes everyone's basements flood. And what can we do to prevent it?
So that is a question that we're mm-hmm. hearing a lot of lately. You know that in terms of climate change, weather patterns are changing.
Mm-hmm.
Whether people, want to think about climate change or not, no one disputes the fact that weather patterns are changing
mm-hmm.
and there's more intense rainstorms. And because of that, the system that was created at the turn of the century
mm-hmm.
and in some ways more recently with the deep tunnel system since the 1970s and 80s,
mm-hmm.
Some of that cannot handle the amount of water that's coming,
mm-hmm.
especially when there are very intense rainstorms for short periods of time. All of that water is trying to get into go through very small pipes. So what we're doing now at the Water Reclamation District is we're looking at green infrastructure.
Okay, what is
and
that?
So green infrastructure is something in terms of trying to handle that precipitation or that stormwater
mm-hmm.
at the front end, rather than building more detention areas or more pipes or more reservoirs,
mm-hmm.
which are a good thing. But this is another tool in our toolbox in terms of trying to manage that stormwater.
Oak Lawn is really looking at 2 different projects right now that are very large projects, multi-year projects, projects we really need your partnership with. One on Cicero Avenue on 103rd Street between Cicero Avenue and Central.
Right.
We're looking to bury some box culverts under the street. We feel we can get 2 to 4 box culverts. A box culvert, do you know what that is?
Yes.
It's like a concrete tunnel. Mm-hmm. They're big enough to drive a car through, actually. They're 8 or 10 feet square. And so imagine all the stormwater that can take.
Right.
And quickly. So the goal is to find a spot for it when it comes down really fast, mm-hmm. and then release it slowly,
right.
so the system can handle it. So that's one project we're working on. The other one, if you look at 111th Street and Cicero, we have St. Casimir Cemetery there, which mm-hmm. is currently the east part of it is developed. The west part is wetlands.
Okay.
It's where Stony Creek comes through. We're looking to turn that into a water detention area as well.
Right.
And that potentially, I think, 400 acre feet of stormwater detention could potentially be there. So that would be huge. And these are things we'd partner with MWRD.
And that can make a huge difference in terms of people's lives. There's no one, like I was saying about mm-hmm. tools in terms of green infrastructure, there's no one project that's going to answer the question mm-hmm. or be the magic bullet mm-hmm. in terms of what we're looking at in terms of all of Cook County. But you're talking about detention areas and the box culverts. All of these sort of components help in terms of relieving the volume that's going mm-hmm. into the system and hopefully the volume that doesn't go into people's basements.
Yeah, yeah. When Oak Lawn was built up in the 50s through the 70s, there wasn't a big plan for detention. In fact, Oak Lawn doesn't have any detention areas. The detention areas are actually all outside Oak Lawn.
Right.
And so it's been a problem. So we're really, really hoping that we can get these projects going. What are things homeowners can do?
So that, you know, there are a lot of things that homeowners can do when we're talking about green infrastructure. Mm-hmm. You know, you look at something like a rain barrel.
Mm-hmm.
A rain barrel can hold about 50 gallons of water.
Mm-hmm.
I know the Water Reclamation District sells rain barrels. I'm not certainly
we
not
have a
doing...
Green, we have a green team that sells them
okay.
also.
Not trying to push
awesome.
Any products
yeah.
here, but in terms of a rain barrel, you can capture 50 gallons of water, which you could use for watering your plants, mm-hmm. washing your car, etc. And you can also have more permeable pavement. And what mm-hmm. I mean by that is something where the water can absorb into the ground mm-hmm. instead of being diverted into the sewer systems.
So just don't pave everything over. So for example, anyone who watches the village board meetings, they always see residents come before us for a variance if they want to put in a swimming pool
right.
because they're outside the impervious surface guidelines.
Mm-hmm.
So they have to actually come before the board. We've gotten pretty
right.
strict with that.
That's
and,
good.
Yeah,
like asphalt and concrete. We know that about 40% of Cook County is mm-hmm. now impermeable pavement. In mm-hmm. other words, that's a surface where water cannot absorb into the ground. And that is adding also, when we're talking about climate change, we're talking about impermeable mm-hmm. pavement, and that's great that you know, Oak Lawn is looking at that in terms of
yeah.
trying to keep a certain percentage you know, permeable pavement. So that helps. If you look at a green roof, anything where the water can absorb into the ground rather than going mm-hmm. into the sewer system is considered
yeah.
green infrastructure.
I was just recently on the City of Chicago's green roof.
Oh.
What a wild
yeah.
Idea that was.
And that's not an easy thing for people to do on a, you know, a day-to-day basis, but City Hall mm-hmm. has certainly committed in
yeah.
terms of looking at things
yeah.
in a sustainable way. But another thing is when the neighborhood looks at green technology, it certainly doesn't make any kind of impact mm-hmm. for one person to have a rain barrel
mm-hmm.
and the rest of the community
right.
not to.
Right.
You have to at least have 50% of the neighborhood on board with something, some kind of tool in you know, their environment
mm-hmm.
to make the impact long-term on the flooding system.
Yeah.
So something to think about.
So in the Chicagoland area, we enjoy such wonderful drinking water.
We're very lucky.
People come from around the world to see what you guys do
right.
and study. And it's really a gift we have in the Midwest to have this wonderful natural resource. And your job is keeping it safe. Can you tell me, I want to talk about two things that affect the safety of our water. One would be pharmaceuticals and then microbeads. I want to talk about that a little bit. So let's talk about pharmaceuticals.
Okay, so we have 20% of the world's fresh water. In our backyard. You turn on the faucet, you get clean drinking water.
So in the whole world, we have 20%.
20% in the Great Lakes. So if you look at states like California that are dealing with droughts right now, you know, we don't have to be that creative in terms of our water, but we certainly don't want to wait till we get to that point in order to be smart about, you know, looking at after our natural resources. And drinking water is something that obviously humans can't do without for more than a couple of days. We can certainly find other routes of energy for our vehicles, but we can't find another substitute for water. There's no recipe to make more water out there. Just a little food for thought for the viewers out there is that whatever water was on the planet during the age of the dinosaurs is the same water that exists today. Just through evaporation and precipitation, it's the same water that's out there. There may be aquifers out there that haven't been tapped into, but in terms of the water supply that we have, that's it. That's all we have right here. So we need to be smart about it.
So when someone has medication and they don't know what to do with, in the past we were told, just flush it down the toilet.
Right.
And now you have all these fish on Prozac and whatever. And,
yeah, you're
and,
right.
And what is that doing to the environment?
So we've got a increase in population that's using pharmaceuticals. And as you said, traditionally people were disposing of their own old pharmaceuticals down the toilet, down the drain. We don't want people to put it into the water supply.
Right.
So don't put it in the don't put, flush it down the drain. Don't put it down the sink.
I have such exciting news for the residents of Oaklawn. We actually got a grant. We were just told recently that CVS is sponsoring a pharmaceutical take-back center for our village hall.
That's great.
So in a short time, and not yet, but soon, in a short time, residents would be able to take those unused medications.
That's excellent. You're making
and
it
keep
easier.
It out of the water system.
You're making it easy for people to do. You have a central location, and that's really what we'd like to do. Eventually, I'd like to see down the line anybody in the state of Illinois purchasing pharmaceuticals have an envelope where they can put any old pharmaceuticals and mail it back to a central location. We're not there yet. There are some states that do that.
Really?
But the fact that you're making it easy for residents is a big plus.
We're so excited about that.
So, you know, you were asking me earlier, we've got a lot of pharmaceuticals that enter the water supply and treatment facilities are not set up in order to take them out. And the same with microbeads. The treatment facilities do not take that out. You got a body scrub or something like that.
Yeah.
Those little beads are made of little plastic particles, and that gets into fish.
Yeah.
And if people, you know, are buying fish and they're going to eat them, some of those particles can be in that.
Yeah, residents may not even know what microbeads are, but if you buy soap, it would be these little balls that kind of exfoliate or
And so. you can have microbeads. I mean, if people want to exfoliate or whatever they want to do, you can have that in other forms like sugar and salt. There's other ways to get that exfoliation without the plastic.
Okay.
So you're helping out the environment as well.
Okay. So fish actually eat that?
It can get into the water supply. Okay. And recent legislation is sort of phasing those microbeads out.
Good to know. Good to know. So another thing, what about like baby wipes and that kind of thing?
Flushable wipes, are another thing that has recently been looked at in terms of the water treatment industry. And although some packages will say flushable wipes, they're not necessarily flushable.
So you recommend just don't flush anything
Throw it in the trash. There is an accumulation of these flushable wipes at various treatment plants that are affecting the flow of the system, and it's just better not to have it in there. Some of them do disintegrate over time, but it takes too much time, so it's better to keep it out.
Okay. Now, MWRD is also one of the largest landowners in Cook County.
Indeed, we are.
Can you tell me about any of the facilities nearby? I know we have that water, I think it's an aeration facility at Route 83 and Southwest Highway.
So we have a lot of land, and people wonder, you know, well, you're a water treatment agency. Why do you have this land? So the policy was very early on when we set up the various treatment centers is that we also wanted access to the waterways. Mm-hmm. And that was important in order to manage the sanitary ship canal, et cetera. Mm-hmm. There's land that accesses those waterways, and the Water Reclamation District acquired that land. So that is what is partially contributing mm-hmm. to the fact that we, you know, have a large land holding. One of our largest plants is in Cicero, the mm-hmm. Stickney plant. Mm-hmm. And if any of your viewers have a desire to go and tour one of our plants, mm-hmm. Or if you'd like to have a tour, I'd be happy to help arrange that. Community groups, schools, mm-hmm. Kiwanis clubs, Lions,
so
you know,
any
of them can
come. How would they get in touch with you?
They can call my office at 312-751-5650.
Can you say that one more time slower?
Sure. 312-751-5650 if your group or community group would like a tour of one of our plants.
Thank you. Sure. I don't want to take too much of your time, but I would be remiss if I didn't thank MWRD for helping make our CalSAG Trail a reality. This is a bike trail that runs from Lamont, and it will go to Burnham Harbor. And most of the land that it's on, I believe, is MWRD land.
That's right.
And you arranged for the bike trail to be on there as part of, you know, just a really supportive thing for the residents and the community. In Oak Lawn, we're super pumped about our bike trails. We are hoping to connect our bike trails to the CalSAG Canal. So we're really hoping to do that. But I understand it was a very favorable lease of the land, like a 100-year lease,
yes.
Like $100 a year or something like that. Just an incredible, wonderful gift to the community, and I want to thank you for that.
It's the Water Reclamation District is committed to working with the communities and other government agencies mm-hmm. who, are the direct sort of contact with the citizens, and, you know, you sort of know best in terms of what the needs are mm-hmm. on the ground, and we're happy to do that.
So yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, we appreciate it, and that bike trail is going to be just wonderful. I think it's 24 miles from tip to tip.
I'm going to bring my bike and try to see if I can make it all 24 miles.
Well, I'll ride with you, okay. But give me a couple months' notice to get in
to
shape.
To prepare, okay.
Yeah.
It's a deal.
Yeah, but is there anything else that you think the residents of Oak Lawn would be interested in knowing about MWRD?
You know, we've got a lot of things going on at the Water Reclamation District. We're looking at, becoming more sustainable mm-hmm. As an agency. In terms of our treatment process, the treatment process does have a certain amount of gas that is involved mm-hmm. in it, and we capture that gas and convert it to electricity. Mm. Our goal is in 10 years to become to be sustainable in terms of our electric requirements. We're on a good path for that. We're also partnering with the City of Chicago in order to convert food organic products into energy as well. So, it's a lot of things that probably the forefathers that created our agency didn't think that we'd mm-hmm. be getting into, but it's very interesting. Yeah. It's an interesting time to be involved in this kind of thing as, you know, people are learning that the environment is an important thing and can't be ignored. So.
There's lots of innovative things that you could do, and those are some of them. With Oak Lawn, we have we pump water to 12 communities south and west of us. Mm-hmm. Total of 325,000 people get water through Oak Lawn.
Right.
And we're upgrading our pumps, and the pumps are really cool because as they pump, they also generate electricity.
Right.
And it's a whole new idea, and we're really excited to have that technology.
I'm glad to hear that, you know, the communities are doing that as well.
Yeah,
so that's exciting.
Yeah. Everyone who hears that is just in awe of it because it makes sense. The water's moving through it.
Right.
Why not use
and you've got motion to convert into energy. That makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah, good. Very good. Well, Commissioner, it is such a pleasure. Thank you. I hope to
meet
you again for one of these
thanks for having
TV
me on the
segments.
Show. Appreciate
and
it.
Thank you. And thank you, Oak Lawn. And let's keep our water out of
keep
our basements and keep it clean. Yes, thank you.
Thanks.